Hello again, everyone. This is Gilmer, and this is something slightly different. We're going to play War in Russia. Not going to play it too long, probably about 20 minutes. But since I spoke about it before, I wanted to show you what it looked like. War in Russia, originally copyrighted by Strategic Simulations Incorporated. This was a computer war game built in the 1990s, or programmed in the 1990s, by one Gary Grigsby, who is also the lead designer behind War in the East. So I am going to play the Soviets. I'm going to give the Axis help, and I'm going to play Campaign 41. So let's accept that setup. I'm going to put everything on low, because if I don't, it's going to go really slow, and as it is, it's going to go slow. So what happens is the Axis runs their first turn and they attack. It's Operation Barbarossa. As you can tell, there have been a lot of improvements from this game to War in the East, and the graphics obviously are much better now. You get a look at all the tanks included in the battles, and you get a nice little, I should have probably let you look at that battle report for a little while. But as you can see, the Soviets in the first turn are completely outnumbered, outgunned, out everything. So this is a combat report. Axis land forces attacked using 753 tanks, 1,396 squads, and 444 guns. And the Soviets defended with 48 squads and 56 guns. And they got demolished. There's some kind of weird noise going on outside. It's stopped now. So anyway, this is War in Russia. Not War in the East, War in Russia. And you'll get a chance to see how so much more simplistic this is than War in the East. It is amazing what, you know, the progression. I mean, really, there's no progression. It's this game and then War in the East some 20-something years later or so, and there's no comparison. This is up near Leningrad. This is near Riga on the Baltic coast. And as you can tell, the Soviets don't have a chance on this first turn. Which they don't in War in the East either. But this is pretty much one of the first war games I ever owned. And believe me, I played the hell out of this. I hope this video comes out well. Because every time yesterday I filmed about 10 minutes and it came out perfect. And then today I've been trying it the last between 5 or 10 minutes trying to record it, and it hasn't recorded very well. So I'm hoping this time it works a lot better. And this is down near Kiev, Minsk, more Minsk. Was it near Minsk? I'm not sure. So I'm gonna just go quicker now. I'm gonna right click the button before the battle even is over, because then the battle report will be, it'll just flip right through it like that. This way it goes a lot faster. Of course, you could do it on no message at all and it would just whip right through this. You wouldn't see hardly anything of what's going on. I believe that over there, that city over there, might be Kiev. And that's the Pripyat Marshes. This system is very simple, very easy to learn. Tank units are the ones with the elongated circle as the icon, and infantry units are the ones with an X. And tank units can move 5 hexes if they're in supply, and infantry units can move 2 hexes if they're in supply, and that includes attacking. So even if you attack on every single one of those movements, you can still move forward. You don't use up your movement points by attacking. You know, this unit could attack 5 times straight across if it wanted to, although I think it's already attacked once, so, or twice. So that's the difference between that's another difference between war in the East and war in Russia. The movements are a lot different. And I think for the Soviet side, once they get shock armies, I think they can move 3 times, which is pretty cool and pretty helpful. But you don't get very many. You get maybe 5 shock armies that you can build. And in this one, so with the way it has movement, you know, there's not really a checkerboard defense, because they don't really slow down once they get in a zone of controls. They just, you know, if they have supply, they keep moving. And so I'm not going to do a zone of control, checkerboard defense at all in this game. I'm going to moving back as fast as possible and build up a line, to a defensive line, to stop them before Christmas or before winter. And then when winter hits, I'll counterattack. And most of the Soviet tanks are PZ4s, PZ3s, some PZ2s, some probably, I don't know if they have Stugs yet or not, but they have some kind of assault gun, it looks like. Man, I don't like that, but we're going to lose. See, they destroyed the Western Front and 677 aircraft. And so this is the casualty report. The Axis lost 589 squads, we lost 3660, and we lost 2700 aircraft and 650 AFVs or tanks. So now it's the Soviets' turn. And my job is to pull back far enough so that I can build a defensive line back here somewhere and save my units. So, what the best way to do this is their supply three, you can do move. And you can move it as many hexes as your supply. So I can move this one three hexes. Now he's supply five, but he's already been moved this turn. This guy has a supply of four. So one, two, three, four. Well, one, two, three, four. If the hex you're going, well, no. For some reason it wasn't going to let me do that one. This guy is supply of six. So we can, the maximum you can move an infantry unit is five hexes, no matter what their supply is. So one, two, four, five. This one is in supply of four. So one, two, three, four. This one is supply of two. So two. This one is in supply of one. I could plot a movement with him, but before October or so, their movements are erratic because their officers are pretty bad. And so it's really, even if you can only just move them one turn, one hex, it's usually better to move them one hex than plot. Now, if your supply is zero, you can't move them, but you can plot them. And so that's where you have to resort to plotting. And hopefully he'll go where you tell him to go. This guy is a zero as well. And we'll move him back. He is a supply of one. We'll move him. Supply of one. Move him. These are supplies of zero, so. And even tanks can't be plotted more than two when they're out, when they have a supply of zero. So those guys are in really, really bad shape. One, two, three. So you can see it's very, very simplistic. One, two, three, four, five. Let's go there. See, I moved him six because he's a tank unit and he's a supply of five. I think if you're a supply of five, you can move him those more than five places. Well, I just did, so obviously. One, two, three, four. So what I'm doing is I'm just going to move these guys on back. And another thing to look at is your OP18. OP18 means that is the amount of movement points or admin points for that HQ. Their HQ is the Southwest Front. As long as that is more than 3 or 4 points, you can move a unit. If it's zero, you need to change that HQ. Change that unit's HQ, because when you move them, they'll lose a lot of cohesion. I didn't even look at that guy, but this guy's at 8 for his movement. See, they're down to 5 for the Southwest Front. And that's what this guy is. So let's see. I've already moved him, so we'll move him 1 back. That's Zhytomyr. That's Minsk. As you can see, his OP is 0. That means that's because they destroyed, I think, the West Front, which was in here somewhere, I believe. So you need to change his HQ to one that has more points. Operational points, I guess, is what that is for. So he is a 2, but it's not going to let me go 2, so let's move him 1 square. He is at 0, so we're just going to try to plot, because they don't get any supply through these marshes hardly. It's almost impossible to get supply through there. He is at a 3, so let's move him there. Oh, and I didn't check. See, if you caught the little message there, it said insufficient operational points, you know, you lose cohesion. So we got to change the HQ for each one of these And I kind of spread them out some just because you don't want them all in one place, all in one headquarters. Control? No. It's still under my control. It just won't let me move that far. Same with him. Change HQ. We'll move him one. Change HQ. Move him one. Oh. Destination is enemy controlled, so I'm just going to go that way. And he's at zero supply, so I'm just going to move him. I'm just going to plot him. Change HQ. And we can move him this far. Change HQ. And we can move him there. Let's see what's in Minsk. No factories. Change HQ. See, a lot of these need to have HQ change, because if you don't, you're going to be really suffering when it comes to cohesion effects. How did I do? Okay, wait a minute. Change HQ. Yep. So, this turn, no. He has zero as well. Change HQ. And we can move him there. He has good OP points, so we're going to move him one, two. I guess it's that HQ. Yeah. We're going to move that HQ. Yep, there we go. We're just going to move these guys as best as we can out of the danger zone. I don't think it's going to help with some of them. There's, no matter what you do, some of them are going to get caught. But the best thing to do is get as many as you can out of harm's way. And here's another one. See, he's at OP2. I don't think that's enough. So change that HQ to that one. And then we're going to move him. Oops. He's only got supply of 3. So there we go. So I have moved pretty much, well, not this one. We'll move him back. And then we'll move this one back as well, because there's nothing in Odessa that we really need. And so, what? Another thing that you want to do is check your air groups. And there's some. We're going to change their mission to training, because it's really not, if you saw that experience, 21, that's horrible. They're not going to do well. So you want to make sure all of these guys are trained up a little bit, hopefully up to the 50s or so, because if you put them in combat situations with experience of 21 to 31, they're just going to get mauled. Okay. And obviously I'm not an expert like some guys, but I am. You don't necessarily have to be an expert at this game to win it. You just have to be, especially as the Soviets. I mean, I guess as the Germans as well, You just have to use a little bit of intelligence and let's move this guy. Well, wait a minute. Let's put them on training before we move it. You just have to maximize your advantages. And our advantages are going to be, time and space. It takes a while for that, the Germans to get to Moscow and Leningrad. And, it because of the space that it takes for them to travel, they have a long way to go. And they got to get there really pretty much before winter hits. Because if they don't, they are going to loot. Okay, I already put them on training, so let's see. And these guys are going to get hit, probably. They're going to keep trying to hit them, so I'm going to move these units back fairly far, but you can't do it on the first turn, but you can put these in training on the first turn. And so what I'm going to do is just steadily move them out of range of the German air until we get to the point where they're no longer being attacked, and then that'll give them a chance to build up their their airplane numbers. And then when they have a little bit of experience, we'll move them back when we start going on the attack. Now I can add a unit here, and I'm going to add the 81st Army. And the way you, did you see how I did that? Let's just do it again. You put it on an empty hex near an HQ, and you click add unit. You can do it further away, like say I wanted to do one here, and then I'd click add unit, and then you would do, instead of transfer, you'd do rail transfer. And if you have enough rail, you can see there's no men there. Why does it say there's men there? I guess because they're all below 50%. If they're below 50% cohesion, normally they're not going to transfer. I think you can do rail transfer from below 50%, but you can't do just regular transfer. But before I do that, and I'm just going to remove this guy, I think, look for now. Where is a remove unit? Let's see. Remove. Okay. The reason I want to do that is because I want to move some factories first. So the way you move a factory is Dnipropetrovsk is a good city because they have heavy industry of 15. So what you want to do is you place your cursor on, you select the city box, click utilities, move factory. And then you click on it, and it says, do you wish to transport this factory to the Urals? You press Y, and it moves it. I think you can only move one factory per turn. So let's go ahead and, actually I think I want to add it. I want to move these guys into the city because this game can be pretty sneaky. They'll sometimes airlift some people right into the city. I don't know how they'd get away with that, but I think it's an exploit that the game uses, but I don't know that for a fact. But anyway, let's try transfer. And there's nothing that I can do with transfer, so let's try rail transfer, and we'll click on it. And so see, a lot of them, you have a lot of them below 41%. So I'm just gonna, what did it, if you want you can press the letter that corresponds to the unit you want to add. And I'm just gonna add 7 and an artillery, and then that is how you add a unit. So I added the 81st Army, and its HQ is the Moscow front, and he is ready to go. We'll move this guy here. We'll move him here. And it's best to really start getting your guys in place. And I really, the way I like to do it is I like to run a line along this rail line down through here. And if they push me back here, then I'll go back to here. But usually they can't push me all the way that far back. So I guess that's about it for this turn. Yeah, we'll move this guy too. Oh, wait a minute. He has an OP of 0, so we want to change HQ to that one. And then we'll move him back to there. Oh, and this guy, I mean, he's history, but there's no sense. I mean, he might get lucky. I mean, you know, you never know. So, that's the end of the planning of the first turn. And then I will go ahead and click combat and accept. And then it will plot out my turn, or execute my moves that I've planned. And there are literally probably not very many attacks if at all. Oh, see how I plotted him to go southeast and then east, but because they don't always, and before October, their movement is erratic, he went east first instead of southeast first and then east. So that's really screwed him. He's gone. So that was the only combat I had, and it was because the guy didn't follow orders. And that's supposed to be because of the Red Army purge and the units. I like to click escape here and then do this, because then you get the zoomed out map. I don't like the zoomed in map very much. So that unit that I was just saying was gone, it's gone. History. Some of these others aren't going to make it very far either. I don't believe that guy will last very long. I'm not really thinking these three right here in that area are going to last very long either. But, you know, so they do have Stugs, because I just saw them add a Stug battalion to this attack, the Germans. So we're going up against Stugs. I was gonna say you can see where their panzers keep attacking and keep moving forward down. Well, I'm trying to point at the monitor, but down at the bottom of the map, you can see the three panzers lined up one right after the other. Those guys are just going to keep on advancing, and hopefully at some point I'll be able to kind of cut them off a little bit. And see, I lost 923 AFVs, but they're early years AFVs. They're not good ones, and so it doesn't really matter. I mean, it matters, but it doesn't mean that much, because they're not good AFVs that I'm losing right now anyway. So a lot of them were built in 1926. And that is how you play war in Russia. There's not a lot of things that you have to remember. There aren't a lot of things that you have to do to plan your return. One of the things I could have done was change leaders. You are allowed to do that. Although Stalin at some point usually takes over Stavka, which is historically what he did. He got a little pissed off at how his generals were doing, and he eventually took over himself, and he didn't do a very good job from what I remember, if I remember correctly. So I think eventually he, steps down from army command and gives it back to his generals, and Of course, I think that was at the point where Zhukov was brought in, and the rest is history. I don't like that. I should have probably looked at that losses report a little bit longer. But I already know that, you know, they've lost a lot of men. So as you can see, they've kind of, this guy's kind of moved forward pretty well, but we can move these guys back down here. And this guy's a fairly strong unit, so we're okay there. And we're going to keep moving these guys back. This guy has no supplies, so we're going to just try to get him back to our lines, which probably will not happen. These guys are somewhat savable. Oh, that guy had no OP. Change HQ. And he doesn't have, he can't move. Sometimes when you have supply zero, they can't even plot a move. And I don't know what the rules are on that, but I just know it happens sometimes. His OP has two, but he won't let me move two, so I'll move one. Let's see about this guy. Yep, he can move two. He can only move one. He can only move one. You know, if you're persistent, you can get these guys out of trouble. But it takes persistence, because it's going to be very tedious to trying to keep moving one or two hexes at a time. But eventually, you're going to get to the point where your supply is five or so, and then you'll be all right. Did I put them in training? Yep. And I'm moving these guys up a little. I'm moving these guys a little bit forward. This guy up. Moving him a little forward. You can use every unit you can get. I mean, these HQs that are back here a little bit, they have, you know, power of 7, combat value 7. It's not a lot of troops, but it's enough to fill out some formations, and it's smart to go ahead and just move them up and use them. So, he has a 6, supply of 6. So you see how I'm just gradually moving all these guys back. Because what you do is you shorten your lines, and then you start building up your units as best as possible. And a lot of times that means transferring units out of some, like, see how they're all at 44%. When they get to 50%, I can transfer them into another unit, which is what you do. You build up your units that way. And his, whoops, gotta get it right. There you go. He is at 3, 1, 2, 3. He is at 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Zhitomir. Nope, no factories in Zhitomir. We'll just move him back there. And this is, you know, it's hard for them. They can't get through that lake. What they have to do is kind of go around this lake or go around it this way. So that's kind of a natural barrier that you can use to help on your lines. Oh, he doesn't. He needs to change his HQ. And he does too. And he will move back there. remember. Was it? Is it this line that I build, or is it this line? I might go. I might be go back to there, and if that's the case, then I need to go ahead and just start doing it. I think I'm right there. Because one thing I like to do is I like to build my line of defense on a rail line, because then they get the max supply. We'll change his HQ and we'll move him back. We'll change his HQ up. That's not what I wanted to do. Change HQ and move him back. We'll move him back there. Kiev City. So they have two factories, and I'm going to move the heavy industry. Yes. And then let's see if we can't move the artillery. H? No. Not yet. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So he could. Let's move him up just to see if we can't stop him. I don't want him to take that city before we're able to move that artillery. He didn't have enough points. Is he at move. Change H. Damn it. Change HQ. And then move him back. Move him back. And those OPs, those operational points, they're not as important once you get your units to the line that you want them at. So once they're in line, then, you know, I mean, you still want them to have operational points, obviously, but you want them, you know, once you get them in line, then that means that they're not going to be, you're not going to be using up those points by moving them around too much. I think I do it on kind of this line, and then right about here I break and don't go that way. I kind of break down through here and then kind of back through there. I think that's it. But because you don't have the checkerboard defense, you can just pull these guys back as quickly as possible. I mean, it's very ahistorical. It's not what the Soviets did, but it's kind of stupid to not do it. I mean, if you have a chance or a choice. So, I mean, you know, what's the point? So, I want to, let's see, Smirnov is Commander 3, let's change him to, we got several 5s, let's go ahead and change him to a 5, and what about this guy? Now see, he's an 8, that's pretty freaking good, to be honest. Did I move him? Yeah. And then this unit, I mean, I think they get to this point, really. I probably should come all the way back that far, but it's kind of like a line that goes through about like this and down through there and then down all the way down to here. Stalino, I think, has recon, so that's the end of this turn. So let's go ahead and save, and then let's do combat. So again, I have not plotted any actual combat moves, but I have plotted movements, and hopefully none of my guys will disobey and actually attack them, but I'm sure it would probably happen. Oh, so since the start of the game, since, you know, three turns or whatever, I've lost 5,976 squads, which I think are about 20 to 30 men, and they've lost about 852. So I've lost about 150,000 men, give or take. You know, it might be 40 or 50 guys, I don't know. But, oh, that was just in two turns. This is the next turn. And again, I'm going to press escape and hit accept, and it'll zoom out at some point. There we go. And what he's doing is he's using the move command instead of the plot command. He's moving units around, and of course it's gone back to zoomed in again, so I'm gonna zoom back out, and they retreated. These units didn't even move. I don't know what they were thinking. That one surrendered. This one will probably, if they're in zero supply and they only can, well, I think if they only have zero supply to retreat into, they'll surrender. I think that's the case. That guy's gone too, because he didn't move when he had a chance, so he surrenders. And then they're just going to push these guys back. They have a hard time attacking through those marshes, you know, once you get back a little ways from them. They tend not to go through those marshes, kind of like in the real game, or not the real game, but in War in the East. They don't like attacking through those marshes, which makes sense. And obviously, there's no sound. I don't think there was ever any sound on this game. I could be wrong, but I don't think they ever put it in. So, after, I guess, the Axis's third turn, I've lost 8,000 squads, which is about 240,000 men, I think. And you can actually look at it, I guess. Look at a squad. Let's see. Let's find one. That's a rifle division. Infantry squads. I guess they don't really tell you. But, so anyway, that's the episode. That's my episode 22 of War in the East, but it's not really War in the East. It's War in Russia. Just to show you what war in Russia was like. And I know that there aren't very many Let's Plays of this out there at all. It's a lot less than War in the East, obviously, because very few people have this. And most of the ones that do aren't doing any videos of it. So anyway, thank you very much for watching, and I will see you next time. There's going to be a little bit of desktop action or here or something as I get out of DOSBox and then stop the recording. So anyway, thanks a lot.